name is Gordon Jones. I want to welcome you all here to the Harvard Innovation Lab. And more importantly, I want to welcome you here to our inaugural kickoff of our Innovation in Sports Challenge here at the iLab. For those of you that haven't been to the Innovation Lab before, we are a cross-university resource where we are pulling together the best of Harvard to help students from across this university who have ideas, insights, innovations, and helping them access the kinds of resources they need, you need, or may want to develop your ideas further, to grow and scale them, and to do so with viability in mind. And one of the most important ingredients, while we have a number of them, are these competitions and these challenges, where you're able to seed your idea, form teams, and get the early traction in developing them. Now, tonight's kickoff of the Dean's Innovation in Sports Challenge is born out of a partnership. At its foundation is the iLab Advisory Board. What makes us cross university is that the deans from around this university and the provost have come together to support this resource concentration that I referenced. But in particular, tonight, the co-chairs of our challenge being Harvard University's Athletic Director Bob Scalise and Harvard Business School's Dean Nithin Noria, who have made this challenge and agreed to serve as co-chairs for this challenge and making it possible. Now, I do also want to thank Bob for another thing. I've visited a lot of innovation labs around this country. We are the only one that has a basketball court, and that comes from the athletic department. So it's a special, special component. Now, Nithin and Bob have challenged the student body of Harvard University to develop ideas to improve the sports industry, the careers of those who work in it, and the lives of those who enjoy sports, both as practitioners and spectators, both those who are amateur and at the professional level, both in the United States and around the world. Now, we are excited here at the iLab to host this challenge while we support students throughout the competition. One of the key hallmarks of the iLab challenges or competitions is that everybody gets something. While there ultimately will be finalists and winners, there's a series of things we try to do to help you progress your ideas in the spirit of the iLab and taking them as far as they can go. And we look forward to seeing what kinds of novel solutions you come up with in addressing these challenge topics. Now, tonight's program includes remarks from Bob Scalise and Nithin Noria, as well as a fireside chat, which will include Robert Kraft, Chairman and CEO, and Jonathan Kraft, President of the Kraft Group, the New England Patriots, the New England Revolution, and several other business interests, moderated by Anita L. Bursi, the Lincoln Filene Professor of Business Administration at Harvard Business School, who also serves as our faculty lead in this competition. Thank you to Bob and Nithin for co-chairing the challenge. Thank you to Robert and Jonathan for being our keynote speakers, and thank you, Anita, for moderating. So to begin the programming tonight, I'd like to bring on stage the Dean's Innovation in Sports Challenge co-chair, the Nichols Family Director of Athletics, Bob Scalise. Please join me now in welcoming Bob to the stage.
Thanks, Bob. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Gordon. It's great to be here. It's great to see so many people interested in sports. And part of the interest in the challenge from my perspective is that I've realized from when I was an MBA student here at HBS, we are in a sports-crazed society. People love sports. Okay, why? There's competition. People love arenas where competitive spirits come out and people can see the results of other people's efforts. Okay, there's an uncertain outcome. That's also why things are very important in sports. And sports also brings together people who want to pursue excellence, okay, and to show how good they really are. And I can tell you from talking to parents, talking to college athletes, talking to pro athletes, people will do anything and everything they can possibly do within the spirit of the rules in order to perform well and to win. It's a great venue and is worthy of people's attention from the business perspective. We think this is important to make sure that everyone here is aware of the opportunity. And the opportunities that I see going forward are ones that really cut across areas, whether it's business and science and ethics. These are all opportunities, okay, for people to explore opportunities in the sport industry. Our categories, some of the categories that are our main areas of focus are the athlete and athletic performance. And that could be how to improve the performance of athletes, but also how to make it safer for athletes. Okay, nowadays you can't pick up the newspaper without realizing that safety is a big part of participation in athletics. Career and health during and after sports. Okay, so what do people do who go into sports? Jeremy Lin, one of our players, wound up calling me just the other day and said, "Bob, I'm playing, I'm on the Lakers, it's awesome, but what do I do when this all is over?" Okay, what does he do? How does he manage his brand so he has opportunities later on? Improving the fan experience. Technology today is increasing the opportunities for fans to get involved and participate. And just the information that's out there, okay, is unbelievable. Fantasy football. 40 years ago, fantasy football really didn't exist. Today, fantasy football fans, they have as much information about teams and players as anybody. More, yeah. Sometimes they have more. They have advice, that's for sure, right? Rethinking the sports industry. What kind of business are we in? I know in college sports, people are really thinking, what business are we in? Are we in a business? Are we in education? What do we do? Okay, are we in the business of televising games and media? How will digitization efforts impact TV revenues that come in? Is it a fan experience kind of thing? Is it a ticket sales? Is it a concessions part of the business? There are many opportunities there. And then sport and social impact. Okay, this is a very important thing. Why play sports? Why so much emphasis? How do we keep things in balance? These are all things that are very important for us to be looking at as we go along. And so I want to just add my welcome and hope that we get some exciting ideas by bringing everyone together and doing all of this cross-fertilization of ideas that the iLab is trying to foster with this. Should I turn it over to Nathan or to Anita? Okay, and now I'd like to turn it over to Anita Elberse for a few comments and for our fireside chat.
We all know who you are, but just to highlight a few of the major things. So Robert Kraft graduated from the Harvard Business School in 1965, founded International Forest Products 7 years later, and that became one of the largest privately owned paper trading companies, which in turn developed into the Kraft Group, which is a group that has a variety of different businesses. In 1994, and that I think is one of the reasons why you're here, he bought the New England Patriots for what was then a record $172 million, which sounds like peanuts now. and turned it into what I think we can safely call a model franchise within the NFL, presumably worth well over $1.5 billion at the moment. Also owns the New England Revolution, which is the Major League Soccer team. And Jonathan was saying when we were talking beforehand that that was once a struggling league, but is now actually looking pretty good too. And there's a recent television deal that I think is showing the way forward. So that is also looking quite good. One of the NFL's most admired and influential owners, Robert Kraft, serves on the NFL's Broadcast, Finance, Labor, and Compensation Committees. There must not be any other committees that one can serve on, so which is quite amazing. The most remarkable thing is that he's won the Super Bowl three times. And this year, I think we're all looking for that fourth. So please join me in welcoming Robert Kraft. Jonathan Kraft also earned his MBA from the Harvard Business School, not very original, in 1990, and serves as the president of the New England Patriots and as an owner investor of the New England Revolution, and also, as was said by Bob, as a president of the Kraft Group more generally. He serves at the NFL on the Digital Media and Business Ventures Committees, but also does a number of other things outside those activities. Serves on the board of directors for organizations such as the Children's Hospital Trust, the Board of Trustees for William College, the Belmont Hill School, and Massachusetts General Hospital. And in his free time, I don't know where he finds that free time, but also coaches Little League Baseball and youth soccer. Please welcome Jonathan Kraft. So one element that was stressed in both of the remarks we've heard so far is that the Sports Challenge is all about building bridges between the different schools and the different departments that we have here at the university. And Jonathan mentioned that you used to advise your children that building bridges between people is the way to go, and that it creates great outcomes. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Well, we're living in an age of technology, and I was thinking in 1972, if I had had access to technology, how much easier it would have been to build a business. And I think what's happened now, even in sports and everything, that we're all focused on our handheld instrument there that makes us so efficient. And I think what's happened there's brilliance that's come out of it and efficiencies and all new industries. But I think to a certain extent, we've lost the sense of building relationships and investing in relationships. And if I've had any success in business, it's doing that on a global basis and building a sense of trust and confidence. And I think whether it's in Washington today or international affairs, that's broken down. So I think what Nithin has done here, together with this great group in partnership of, we compete, John, and by the way, I just say, Jonathan's happens to be my best friend and business partner, who happens to be my eldest son. So he's been a full partner in everything I've done, and probably I get too much of the credit, but he's been right there alongside of me. And I guess the best part of Harvard Business School is my first year when I was productive, and he came, and so it's pretty cool. Well, I guess most people would think, is that politically incorrect?
We all know how it works.
Okay, I'm still trying to figure it out. But breaking down, and academia or medicine, because we've been talking about a philanthropic gift. Oh, there's so much in precision medicine. There's so much being done and great work being done, but it's not integrated. No one's connecting the dots. And here, you're breaking down the silos and trying to get away. I wish I had an opportunity to participate in something like this. I might have never finished.
I think it's not too late. I think you can participate too.
Well, I look for, yeah, thank you. Anyhow, I don't know if I...
We want to fund the winner. So we'll wait to see who the winner is, and then we'll fund the winner.
Great. Yeah, so that building bridges is something we're definitely going to be focusing on. I'd love for the both of you, actually, to comment on this. One of the topics is this notion of rethinking the sports industry. And I mentioned this idea of you investing in the Patriots at a time when most people were very skeptical about the value of making these investments in teams. What have you learned about what it takes to build a business in sports? And therefore, what advice would you have for people that are looking to do the same?
Well, I'll give my answer to that. That, when we paid $172 million, it's the only time in my married life that my sweetheart questioned my judgment, because we paid the highest price for any sports team anywhere in the world. And it had the worst one-loss record the 5 years before we bought it. It was 19 wins and 61 losses. It had never sold out in 34 years. So the games, most of the time, were blacked out locally. And
it had negative EBITDA. You might want to, this is Harvard Business School, yep. So you might want to mention that too. Yep.
But, I don't know that I've ever said this anywhere. But one of the reasons I'm passionate, I to all the young people here who are living your dreams, don't be afraid to fail, but really go after the things that you're passionate about. And when it doesn't go your way, keep coming back if you believe in it. And that's sort of the story of how we did this. But the other thing about the team and that was unique for me, I know I have bad ADD. So as you grow older, you're looking for things to do all the time. And a sports franchise to me, and something I love, was a way to compete. Every year, there's new things, there's new challenges. You have to rethink how you compete at the highest level. And the other thing that a sports team does, and I was able to sell my sweetheart on that when we paid a big price with negative EBITDA. She was a professional volunteer and philanthropist in terms of her time and energy. I said, if we do a good job running this franchise, we can have a bigger social impact in the community than if we gave away $500,000 a week. And I think, you know, they're so, music and sport are the only things that really bring a sense of community. I guess religion as well. But that this crosses the lines. And so that's the turn on for me and why I pursued it as something that I was passionate about.
I think what my earliest memory of childhood was was in 1971. And we lived in this little house, and I used to go meet my dad at the front door. And he came home one day in 1971, and I knew my dad liked football. I was 7 years old, and he had one of those old rectangular hard leather briefcases with the little codes, and he came in and he put his briefcase down and he opened it, and he opened it up and there were these white perforated strips with the old Patriot logo in black and white on it, and he said, "You see these?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "These are season tickets to the Patriots in their new stadium. They had opened up the old Schaefer Stadium." And those tickets created an amazing foundation for my dad and my brothers and I. As kids, every Sunday, we would go to the games. And my mother, the same one that wasn't crazy about the purchase price because she thought it would impact her philanthropic capabilities, also was adamant about us going to religious school on Sunday mornings. And she thought it was going to be a problem for that. And my dad told her it wasn't, but he used to sneak letters under our pillows to give to our teacher to get out early, which my mother never knew about.
She never went to the game, so
She didn't care about football in those days. But so we started going. And I think like any of you who think about starting businesses who come out of Harvard Business School, you see something and you just know because you love the product so much, you could do it better if you had the chance. And my dad and my brothers and I would talk about it, and this is in the 70s, and then my dad fortunately did well, and he talked about perseverance. I have a Boston Herald from 1985 when I was a senior in college that said my dad had bought the team. And the person who owned it then, it was complicated, and I won't walk everyone through the details, but basically the deal fell apart at the end, but my father persevered. He felt passionately that we could do a better job and that it was an important civic type of institution. And so over the course of the next decade, we continued to persevere. And right before we bought the team in 1994, we were in an elevator. The last game of the 93 season, which was the Patriots won in overtime. And as we were going down the elevator after the game, we were at the game. We didn't own the team yet. People thought it was the Patriots' last game in Foxborough because they thought the team was going to be sold to a guy that wanted to move it to St. Louis. And my father looked over at me and my brothers, and he just said, "There's no way." We were in the throes of the negotiation. We aren't going to buy this team. And I think that's the passion where, as an entrepreneur, sometimes, even if there is a negative EBITDA, if you have a passion and a real belief, a true internal belief, not an ephemeral belief, that you can make something happen, you need to pursue it. And he always taught us that at a young age, too. Now, when we go to him these days and we have negative EBITDA businesses and say, "Dad, we really believe," he goes, "But there's negative EBITDA." And then you point to the Patriots.
Well, just one other failing, just to finish this story. I'll never forget talking to my sweetheart, and I said, I just want you to know tomorrow we're going to probably buy the team. And the economics number is 115, and we might go to 120 or 122. And then we went out to St. Louis. We flew out there, and we paid 172, which, you know, like 50% more. So, you know, but there's a message in that for all the entrepreneurs in this room, that you sometimes in life, it's not the statements, it's not, you have to be able to feel and see things instinctively that you feel is right, and believe in yourself enough that you're willing to step up and take the risks. And really the difference I've found between people that have a sense of fulfillment or have done it or not done it are people who are willing, a lot of people who talk fancy and, you know, a coulda, shoulda, woulda, but there's times in life when you're faced with that crucial decision, and you can't be afraid to fail if you believe in yourself. So I just tell you, step up and go for it. And you know, you got to do your homework. You can't be foolhardy. And we sort of felt we could make things happen. And fortunately, we had a good team of people, and we did. But that would be one thing, because so many times in life, and with this idea lab, there's going to be things that people think are ridiculous. And you just push for it and go for it in your own way.
Absolutely, absolutely. You are not just successful in sports, but in a wide variety of different sectors. You mentioned one difference that might be in sports, which is this notion that you have to compete every year and you have to maybe rethink the model every year. Are there other unique challenges or opportunities that you see in the sports sector when you compare them with these other ventures that you have in other sectors?
Well, I think, and I'll let Jonathan speak to this, but one, I mean, I really think I'm 35, by the way. You said I was a class of 65, so that would make it hard. But being around my son and my other sons and my grandkids and just seeing how things change, I mean, if you don't embrace change and willing to learn from it, and, you know, I think Jonathan has been terrific on the analytics and using modern techniques. You know, our job continuously is to get the artisans in their silos to come together and connect the dots and put their egos aside and put team first. I mean, whether it's philanthropy, business, sports teams, it's all the same thing. And that's what I think the iLab is trying to do.
I think the one big difference, there's a couple differences in sports from our other businesses. The obvious one is that it's extremely visible. And while if you own a public company, you have shareholders who've actually made an investment with their money, when you have a sports team, anybody who has any passion for it that lives in this community or wherever they live that love it feels like they're a shareholder, and we want them to feel that way, and the media covers it. And when the media is covering your business like that, it's even different than the challenges that somebody like Jeff Immelt has at GE with, you know, 100 analysts who then go out and there's maybe, you know, 50 funds that really matter and you can cater to them. Here, we've got 50 people who cover the team on a regular basis and communicate to millions. And I think we don't pay a lot of, I really don't, I go places and people reference it, but I think paying attention each day to what's being said is important to understand what's being said, but not to get caught up in the emotion of it or care that much, because it really is ephemeral. So that would be one, I think, big difference. But the other thing that I think is different from the business side is our other businesses are capital intensive commodity businesses in paper and packaging. And every day you're fighting competition on the P&L side of the ledger. In football, the competition has nothing to do with the, indirectly, it has to do with the P&L because people might not frequent your venue as much if you're not successful. But Bill Belichick worries about getting, you know, putting the best 53-man roster together and getting them ready to play the next competitor. And we don't have competitors. There is no other football team on the business side of football that we compete with. So running the business operations is just making sure you've got great customer focus and creative, innovative ideas that engage your community. In our other businesses, we worry about our competition on the business side all the time, and that's what Bill has to worry about. And that wasn't articulate, but I think those are the two big differences.
Well, the other difference, too, is, I don't know, I go into Dunkin' Donuts every day, and I have 10 armchair coaches, the front of the line and behind, telling us.
And he buys everybody their coffee, so they go easy on him.
We I'm trying to prepare them for when we might not have the same one-loss record. So, but random acts of kindness, buying Dunkin' Donuts coffee is good and it makes you feel good. But, you know, Jonathan made a good point, too, that we run the business that's most visible in a way that we feel is right. We don't also, I mean, you know, most people's focus is short term. And being private, we have the privilege of thinking long term, making difficult decisions sometimes in the short term for the benefit of the long term. And especially in the football business with a salary cap, if you want to, every team has a shot to be good 1 year. And because of the cycle, when you play better, you know, you have a better record, you draft higher, and then you have a tougher schedule. So it's always stacked against you to do well. And so if you want to be good year in, year out, you have to be working it every day and not listening to what the popular things are. You got to get good people around you that know what they're doing and not be afraid to do the difficult things as long as they're in the best interest of the institution.
Right. Well, let's talk a little bit about getting those good people around you, and then particularly the talent on the field. Two of the five topic areas in the challenge deal with athletes, their performance, their career, how they can best manage their career, how teams or leagues might make investments in talents. And you have said in previous interviews that you've made decisions in some of your best bets have come through intuition. Hiring of Bill Belichick, the bet on Tom Brady in the sixth round. Is that still the case? Are you still making those talent decisions based on intuition, or has that shifted over the years, and is there more of the analytics that you mentioned that comes into play now?
Well, we use analytics. We let our professional people make the decisions. We hire our coach who decides. And we try to hire good people in all our businesses, give them autonomy, push them hard to be excellent, encourage them to be bold and take risks. But we let them do their job. And for me, it's easy. For John, you want to hire people that are smarter than you are and hold them to a high standard. And, you know, that's really one of the key things in life is whether it's your partner, your spouse, or key businesses, hang out with good people, people of good character and integrity, and who are loyal and hardworking. You know, and if you do that, you know, we always say brains is the last thing, because you can buy brains, but you can't buy those other qualities.
If you were to ask Bill Belichick about football players, you clearly need a baseline level of athleticism and talent and skill. But when you get above whatever that baseline level is by position in his world, I think he pretty much throws pure talent aside and goes to passion, toughness, and intellect for the game. Because having the passion for the game, having the physical and mental toughness that's needed to play professional football, to prepare yourself mentally and then deal with the physical challenges, and then the intelligence to understand that in his system, you're going to be up for an intellectual challenge every week is important. So you, once you're above the baseline, those things matter. And then what he's really done, and I think been a little bit ahead of his game, now there are other coaches in the league doing it, is look to find things unrelated to what people have always thought was about football preparation to help maximize the physical capabilities of each person who can make his roster. So our players, when we first came into the league 20 years ago, the strength and conditioning program for an offensive lineman was the same as it was for a quarterback and a defensive back. And literally the food they were eating and the calories they were consuming were virtually the same. And nobody was monitoring other activities outside of the building. And today, all of the players have personalized programs to help them develop to their best, to their fullest potential for the position they play. So it's not just strength and conditioning, it's diet, it's how many hours a day are they sleeping, it's what are they doing to rest their mind when they're not in the building. And I think Bill, to his credit, has focused on that. Bill's not a doctor, he's not a scientist, but he's followed what my dad has said, is go out and find people that are smarter than you. He has a connection at the Naval Academy, for example, and he thinks Navy SEALs go through a lot of what football players do, and he's started to take his ability to access that program and make our football players better.
But, you know, just picking up on what Jonathan said, any of the young people out here who are thinking about an opportunity, if there were a way for us to predict, you know, everyone coming in to the NFL is high ability, but the people who will remain hungry, like Brady. Brady is as hungry for success today as he was 15 years ago when he was the fourth quarterback. I mean, he was the fourth quarterback on our chart, and he was the 199th pick. So, you know, it made me wish. We had Bill Parcells as our coach then, and I remember, you know, I mean, no, sorry, Bill Belichick had just come in. But we were spending millions of dollars on our pro personnel people and college personnel to pick people. And here you have one of the greatest players of all time. All 32 teams let him go five rounds and missed him. So that I would like someone to get the analytics of how we find people like that. But part of it is someone who has a chip on their shoulder, good character, but is hungry. And when they do have success, won't fall for all the trappings that happen that dilute their ability to accomplish at a high level, keep them hungry. And if someone here can do that, that's pretty valuable.
Injuries are another problem, and it's been well documented. The role of concussions and the sometimes devastating long-term effects that those concussions can have. The goal is not to rehash that entire debate because it's a very complex debate, but my question is there room for outside business ideas there as well? Do you see that that our students or anyone who's affiliated with the university in some capacity, can they contribute to that debate or can they contribute to those solutions to those problems?
First of all, we want to say the health and safety of our players. You might be reading in some liberal media one particular newspaper that would like to, I see football eliminated. You know, there's nothing more important to us than the health and safety of our players. But another idea for anyone, if they could predict to us, we have people who come in very highly drafted and low drafted, and the body types can last 7-8 years and some get injured right away. If there was a predictability factor on what, I mean, we're doing all the technical things in nutrition and training, but still, I mean, I can just think of a player we brought in at many millions of dollars a year who has the ability, but is the opportunity loss is so great because they're not playing more than one third of a season. So when you have 16 games, that's what makes it so unpredictable. And if there was a way of predicting that across a large population, that would be very helpful to us.
Do you think about the life of NFL players, or even soccer players, after their careers as well? And is that an area that you devote your energy to and try to look for solutions there? Because there are huge problems there as well. There's divorce, there's crime, there's suicides even. So this is, they're well-documented problems. Are those the kinds of things that you also look for solutions?
You know, we do a lot in that area in player development. Jonathan, I don't want to monopolize.
No, you're not. The NFL and the players' union, our players' union, have worked together to create a bunch of opportunities for players while they're playing to develop a foundation for when they're done. They can't be forced to do it, but it's there. One of the programs, and Dominique Foxworth is here, who was the president of the NFLPA, and he's
good,
now,
and we can
he's
thank
now an
him.
HBS student.
And we can thank him that there's games on the field for the decade because he helped negotiate it, the contract, and did a great job.
And well, one of the things players now, at the league's expense, can go in the off season to business schools like Harvard, like Wharton, like Stanford, start to get a business career. There are internship programs. There are resources that are really fantastic along many different professional levels, internship programs, but a player has to want to do it. And I know we try to get veteran players and recently retired guys to come in and talk to them, but a guy has to want to do it. And some of them are motivated. People like Dominique are motivated, and other people just aren't. And I think that's life. It's our job to make sure they understand what the resources are and why they're important. But I think you have to probably, like anything in life, there are people with different levels of motivation.
Absolutely. You mentioned, moving on to another topic altogether, one other area in the sports challenge is improving the fan experience. And you specifically refer to the role of engaging these different communities. You seem to have done a great job with Patriots Place, providing all these different services and resources for fans. What have you learned about engaging fans and building?
When we bought the team in 94, that was really the year the internet came into public consciousness a little bit. You'd start to see ads on TV where they'd give a URL and people would start to reference it, and the dial-up businesses were hitting people's homes. And we looked at the internet in the early days as an awesome opportunity because one of the things we felt was that fans aren't just the people that spend their money with you, that even if somebody just has passion for your team and wants to spend their limited resource of time and give it to you, we should be in a position to give them opportunities to engage with us. And the internet created a medium for us to do that, so you didn't have to wait for the morning paper. It's alien in today's world, but going back to the early 90s and before, if you wanted to follow a sports team, you either read the daily newspaper or you watched that 2-minute sports cast in the 6 o'clock or 11 o'clock news, and that was it. Or if you had ESPN, you could watch ESPN in those days. And so one of the things we said is we are going to focus all the time, 7 days a week, on finding opportunities to give people the chance to engage and be immersed in the team. And I won't bore everybody with what we've done, but I think we've been a leader in that area. And then Patriot Place is an example of if you want to come down and be around where the team and stadium are, not just on game day, we are going to give you dining and entertainment and retail options to do that. And that's worked out. And now as the world has evolved, stadium experiences used to be one where there was a little tiny video board and you were bombarded with ads all game long. If you come to a Patriots game today, we don't run ads on our video boards. We run replays and animation that we think will excite the crowd and provide data that we think they want. You can, for the last 5 years in our stadium, your handheld devices can access a broadband system that will allow up to 40,000 people now to stream rich media at once. And we spent a lot of time investigating this and installing it and then developing applications so that now when you're sitting in our building, you can use the Game Day app to scroll back to any play that's taken place on any drive, watch it from five different angles over and over again if you want to do that. Call up the statistics or check where the shortest bathroom lines are. And so that's what fan engagement is today. And 20 years ago, we thought hard about focusing on the web. And, you know, my father, to his credit, because I remember I went and said to him, hey, we're going to go spend, I think it was $5,000 or $10,000 to put up a website, which was a lot of money. What's a website? You know, it was 94. And my father said, I don't know what it means, but it sounds like it's a good idea if it's going to let people interact with. This is 94. No one knew what it was. But if it's going to let people interact with us directly, and we started putting up Bill Parcells' press conferences in real time, and that was the first great application that people loved. So.
And Jonathan has done a great job driving this. And, you know, I think Gordon mentioned in the introduction about fantasy football, and there are 40 million people, 43% of them who are women, and we want to encourage that more. So at our game, the stats are available, and it's facilitated for you. But there is an old traditional thing, and I think of the Harvard-Yale game this weekend, and people coming back to campus, they tailgate, they enjoy it. We're privileged to have 20,000 spaces around our stadium. And people, believe it or not, on a 4 o'clock game will want to get in at 9 or 10 in the morning and stay an hour or two afterwards. So we really represent a full day of entertainment. It's beyond the game on the field, and it is that sense of community, and it's tapping into that and making people feel proud to brand and identify with you and trying to conduct your business and everything you do. People in business and with sports franchises want to feel connected, or people in companies, they want to get paid well, but they want to feel they're part of something special and bigger and that they're dealing with good people. So that's a big part of what drives us.
What are the two or three challenges that you'd love our students to solve when it comes to managing the fan experience? Are there two or three items on the list where you say, if only we had solutions for that, we'd be a lot happier?
The greatest thing, we think the biggest challenge that our fan experience on a game day, you're talking about, yep, Professor, is the egress problems for traffic. If you, when 70,000 people leave a place all at the same time, we know it's never going to be perfect, but we have spent a lot of time focused on that, and we can make very, very marginal improvements, but haven't been able to solve it. And if anybody has ideas, it might mean some way of getting them to stay there longer so not everybody's leaving at once, but if someone can come up with an algorithm or a plan for helping us more, if, I guess Google's working on it with the self-driving cars, which will probably help us, but we might not all be alive when that happens. So that would be one, I think, big thing. I think any type of application, too, that explains the game to people. I think everybody thinks they're an intelligent fan, and some really are, and some might have some insecurities about it. But to help break down the game in a way that non-experts can actually understand it too, an application that in real time did something like that, I think would be a would be a really cool thing too, that could be a companion piece to either watching on TV or in the stadium, so that people who weren't as comfortable with the game could understand it. And then that would help us take the game internationally too, which has been our biggest hurdle. And it's just explaining the game to people who don't grow up with it. It's intimidating. But once they get it, they fall in love with it.
I think, boy, I underline the last thing that Jonathan said for any of you entrepreneurial, innovative people. If you can do that, the NFL, I think we have the best sport product. I mean, I don't know cricket.
He looks at Nathan.
I've been watching it on the telly in London for years. And I think that's the way a lot of the world looks at football. But I use my late wife's great lady, who never, for 25 years, I used to take my sons, and she would do the Sunday crossword puzzle in ink from the Times and chick flicks. And then I bought the team for all this money. She said, I better pay attention. And she started coming to games, and she understood. She learned how intelligent it is and how special it is, and just became a passionate fan. And I think women who are doing fantasy football, who learn about it, see it. We're now playing games in London, and you know, we sold out three games, 85,000 people at Wembley like that. And I'm probably not supposed to say this if you're recording, but our game is made for if a person likes to wager, which I'm told they like to do in Europe and Asia, our game is made for that. And so that if we could bring it to the rest of the world, the app that Jonathan described, that would be fabulous. And it is something that is very special. You know, soccer is the global game because it's available to everyone, and it's simple, and people understand it, and people play it in every country. But we'd like to be able to bring this game globally.
We're almost out of time, and I want to make sure that I leave sufficient time for Nitin to also say a few words. My last question is a very simple one. How confident are you that you actually are going to be making it to the Super Bowl this year, and should we be buying our tickets to Arizona right now?
Speak to Gronk, because he'll... No, we're not confident. You know what? The season doesn't begin till after Thanksgiving, and, you know, I think of the last time we were privileged to be in the Super Bowl was 11, and I think our record was 13-3 in the regular season. And we played the New York Giants, who lost five games in a row in the middle of the season and made it as a wild card at 9-7 record. And in the last minute and a half, they beat us. So... We've been there, and that's the objective and aim, but there's a lot of things that can happen, and that's why we need a lot of good apps from your people here to help us get to the position so we can keep putting the team in a better position to get there. Are you coming if we go?
If that's an invitation, then yes.
You're on.
Great. So I think this was a highly successful event already because of that outcome right there. Please join me in thanking Robert and Jonathan Kraft. And I think, Nitin, I think the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. So I have already bought tickets to Arizona, whether I get an invitation or not.
Nathan's a season ticket holder long before he knew us.
So, you know,
in the third tier. That's a real fan.
So it is really interesting, right? Like when I was given the opportunity to work with Bob to launch this challenge, nothing could have been more exciting. I don't know about each of you, but you know, you all have these memories in your life of days that are powerful days that get etched in your memory forever. And for me, the greatest memory of my life, or at least one of the five, and I can't say greatest because I do have to remember the day I got married. Otherwise, my wife will kill me. One of the most remarkable memories was sitting in the third deck off the stadium in the Snow Bowl, watching the great Tuck rule come in our favor and have the team win. I till today will remember that moment till my dying day. And there's something about sports that does that to you. And each person has their own favorite moment and their own favorite passion. And so how do we bring more such moments to people's lives? Moments that become these transcendent moments that become a part of your life. That's what sports does. In many ways, this challenges an invitation to the great imagination of people at Harvard to say, you know, what can we do with this amazing human encounter called sports that then creates business and creates innovation and opportunities that surround sports in many, many ways. I'm just reminded of, we heard at great length what it means to build a great professional sports team. But you know, there's opportunities all around. I mean, we have to remember that Under Armour wasn't a great clothing company until recently. And here's a clothing company that came out of nowhere and created a complement to sports that's a remarkable thing. I remember writing one of my first cases on Reebok. This was, you know, we have to remember that there wasn't such a thing called athletic sports shoes. And then that became a category, and there are now remarkable companies in that space. If you think that those are bizarre things, one of our alumni has built a company which just focuses on, you know, as having had two daughters who routinely were in skating competitions. Every year, if you have ice skating, you know you have to buy them a dress. Those dresses are costly. There's one company that has 60% of the market for those dresses. That's a good business to be in. So if you just allow your imagination to roam, the number of opportunities that abound in the context of sport are remarkable. And what I hope that this challenge will unleash is that full range of possibilities, from someone who invents the next fantasy football to someone who finds something that's a niche, but a very powerful niche in which you can build a great business. So let your imagination roam. That's what these Harvard challenges are about. And let's see if we can come up with something that Robert and Jonathan will want to invest in at the end of it all. But more than anything, I want to thank you both for your inspiration for this challenge, for having built the kind of team that inspires us all to love sports, think about what we might do in sports. Bob, for you, for all that you do to make athletics be such a vital part of this great university. And while we're known for our academics, I think we're also, as the Harvard-Yale game comes about, we have to remember that we have how many? One of the largest collections of athletic teams in any college. So we have, we always think about the big sports, but let's not forget the small sports and these challenges too. It's important for us to remember that there are opportunities for the people who play lacrosse or the person who's in the fencing team. I met someone who was here today, Rufus Lumbery, one of our graduates, who was here for the 125th year of fencing at Harvard. So it's just important to remember that what's remarkable about sports is that there are many different ways in which people engage in it, and each and every one of them provides an opportunity for our imagination to ask the question, what could I do around this space that would be something that's innovative or something that's imaginative? So I'm truly privileged to be your partner in this challenge. And I can't tell you how much I'm looking forward to seeing what the imagination of our students will produce in terms of the ideas that come out of this challenge. Thank you all for being here. We look forward to some amazing ideas. Make us proud and find the kind of things that will make the next generation of athletes and the next generation of sports fan feel amazed about what sports can do. Thank you for being here.